Hello, everybody, and welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. And obviously, I'm Dave, and here with Rich. And this one is called A Look Back, because we're going to be looking back on 2015, first starting out with the, I guess, more semi-personal events, you know, more PSEC-related stuff and people in our general sphere of influence, and then moving on out to world events. And so, yeah, we're kind of gonna technically start this with just the tail end of 2014, because at the time, we did a nice little PSEC episode called PSEC 2014 December Strangeness. And we're going to start off kind of picking up where that actually left off. And it's rather interesting because there was a little part of a certain individual that was mentioned in there, and certain opinions expressed. So it's like for this beginning portion, for shall we say, legal liability purposes, I'm pretty much just going to tell the basics of the story of what happened after that, and Rich is either just going to kind of nod his head and in agreement, or he's going to correct me if I'm wrong, but otherwise he's not going to say shit. Because there's no law against just going, uh-huh, or no. And I'll tell you why legal liability is important. Basically, he was kind of venting out some things about his stepmother's tyranny that he had had to deal with in his childhood and all the way up to now. And, you know, I mean, he was just venting it out to explain, you know, what he had learned from it, and that he's going to be moving forward beyond it, and that he's not going to be locked in a state of victimization by it anymore, that, you know, he's going to take responsibility for himself as a sovereign human being, and, you know, not be trapped in the old cycles anymore, and move forward in a better direction, in a more productive life, which he has indeed done. So, you know, kudos to Rich. So far, he's totally succeeded in that with flying colors. But apparently, his stepmother ended up seeing that video, and apparently she thought that his right to his opinions was somehow a personal danger to her, even though he made no threats against her or didn't give out any personal information like her home address or anything like that. You know, nothing, you know, that could have been in any way considered as a threat against her. I mean, yeah, he had a bunch of derogatory opinions of her, of course, because she's, you know, Hitler without a penis, in my opinion. And, you know, so control freaks being what they are, they don't really like their authority challenged. And when a control freak is using someone as a pawn through mind control, like, you know, she had done with Rich from when he was a little kid all the way on up, and anybody who has had control freak friends or relatives or parents or
I wouldn't say little kid, I'd say more like 11 years old. You know, okay. So just childhood.
Okay.
Tail end of childhood into young teenage years.
Yeah. So anyone who's had, you know, a psychologically and emotionally abusive, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend, teacher, whatever, already knows exactly what I'm talking about. And on some level or another, I think most of us have had those sorts of experiences. Like, I know that as a child and in high school, you know, I was bullied quite a bit. And of course, most of my teachers were not very supportive at all. And my seventh and eighth grade teacher, Mr. Harry Balzania Cipher, and if you look up the word cipher in the dictionary, it says person or thing of no value or importance, which, wow, totally accurate. I laughed when I noticed that definition. He was a total bully. Although I'm thankful for my experiences with him in hindsight, because those really taught me a lot. I'm not going to sidetrack into that. I'm just mentioning that just so people can have references to, you know, relate to as far as the sort of thing Richard has been through. You know, it's not like she hung him upside down by the nuts on a ceiling fan and beat him with an aluminum bat or anything, you know, but very, very manipulative, and would always use him as a pawn, trigger him to then try to create drama within various sides of the family so that the family had to, you know, pick sides, and there was all the stupidity. I mean, you know, I think every family's got at least one family member that's a dramatic fucking control freak. But I digress. Needless to say, she did not appreciate that sort of information being leaked out. And even though she knows that Richard is no physical threat whatsoever, obviously the fact that she can't use him as a pawn anymore was definitely viewed as a threat to her continuity and relations within the family. And that is a very valid viewpoint, because obviously with what ended up transpiring, you know, all, you know, as far as I know, the vast majority of the family, they already knew about her true colors, but they really got to see her true colors. So that was an excuse to totally distance themselves from her and no longer deal with her bullshit. So what's the height of legal stupidity that a total control freak could possibly do? Well, she got a restraining order on him. And was that either just before or right on the 1 year mark of the grand opening of Star Wars: The Force Awakens?
Right on.
So that's when you received the paperwork.
Mm-hmm. December 18th, 2014.
Yeah. So that was very interesting. So basically, you know, he appealed it, went into court, and the judge was a typical globalist tyrannical MF who was openly, you know, saying how, you know, he wanted to, you know, get to lunch on time. And to the best of my knowledge, as far as my understanding of events and accounts and whatever, it seemed that he was basically treating everybody as, you're all guilty, get the fuck out of my courtroom. And so obviously Rich saw this and he's like, oh shit, this isn't looking good for me. So obviously when it came Richard's turn up there, he didn't want to see any of the evidence. He didn't want to hear Richard's side of anything. He again was just like, you're guilty, get the fuck out of my courtroom. And Richard couldn't say shit. So anyway, within the 1 year period from then to now, as I've said, I do believe in the quantum physics and metaphysics of the universe. What you put out is what you get back, and so on. And the universe, the physical reality around you being pure energy and holographic, basically acts as a quantum mirror. And so whatever's boiling inside of you in the internal is going to get reflected in the external as a, you know, kind of a proverbial error message on the computer screen of life to kind of let you know where you're at. So to the best of my ability to understand the events as I have been told them, supposedly the first interesting little part of this is that her car, I'm guessing it was a new car, and though we don't know exactly how much
brand new,
we don't know exactly how much it's worth or what she paid for it or whatever, but based on the description I heard, I would guess it's like a typical between $25,000 and $35,000-ish, you know, just standard car that, you know, you might expect, you know, just about any, you know, middle to upper middle class sort of, you know, person to.
From what I saw, it was like a four-door sedan. It was black colored. It was a manual stick shift transmission, but yeah, anyway,
regular. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, a Porsche or anything, you know, it wasn't like some exuberantly expensive car, just average typical car, but it wasn't like a beater either, it was new. So the first thing that happened, there are longer story details to this, but I'm going to give the abridged version. Let's just say when car meets deer, even though deer loses, so does the car. So she paid however many thousand it was to, you know, to get that fixed. And then not too long after that, the car was parked in her driveway, to the best of my understanding. And in Oregon, things are very hilly, to say the least. So kind of imagine the driveway on a slight slant, and then there's the road and more hilly stuff. And, you know, well, anyway, apparently something malfunctioned with, you know, the gear switching. Something was in neutral, or a parking brake wasn't engaged all the way, or something that was supposed to be locking that car in place. For
what? The parking brake. It was the e-brake that's all on all manual transmission cars. You know, she probably didn't have the parking brake pulled all the way up. It popped out and the parking brake slipped. It rolls back down the hill. It turns off the hill. It goes off the side of the ravine and crunches right into the creek down below.
Like a Hollywood movie freaking, you know, car going off the cliff sort of thing. Although, unlike the movies, this probably didn't go off at high speed. It went off at medium speed. You know, it's not like it was a car chase or something. But yeah, crash, burn, bang, boom. I do not wish anything bad on this woman, but I must say that it was really difficult for me to stop laughing when I heard about this shit. Mm-hmm. Really, really difficult to use profound conscious focus to stop laughing. And took me at least a few minutes there. It was really, really, really hard to stop laughing. I was coughing up a fucking lung, man. It's like, oh my god. The sort of laughing you do when you see, like, Obama make a complete and total epic fool of himself to, like setting new precedents for just new levels of buffoonery, like that type of laughing, to where you just can't help but just, like, fucking, like, bend over and just, like, oh my god. Yeah, so as she's been becoming increasingly more estranged from most of the other members of the family, amidst with little quantum mirror incidences like the double whammy with the car and whatever else she's been going through that we don't really know about and can't say. Well, she's been dealing with all that. Richard's life has been getting progressively better, progressively more confident. He's been getting more responsible, more calm, more patient. And things have been going really well. He was even working at a place called Millionaire for a while. That's in aviation, and aviation is his thing. And, you know, they temporarily let him go, but they said to, you know, reapply back again later, because apparently they had hired too many people or something like that, and the season was...
Basically what happened was the fire season was cut short. They didn't make the kind of money they were expecting off of fuel sales from all of the Forest Service aircraft and private contracted aircraft for the Forest Service that were coming in. Essentially, it was the weather that had cut some of those positions, but that's okay because I am currently in the process of, you know, reapplying. Best of luck there. Fingers crossed.
And, yeah.
You know.
Exactly.
I will get my job back there.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, they just kind of hired too many people based on an assumption that certain things were going to go a certain way and that money would be there, and it wasn't. Because, feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but the things they do on that airfield are definitely seasonal And, you know, it literally, you know, does depend on how certain things within the season are going.
Mm-hmm. Well, that part of the fire air attack base is all seasonal. That's a summertime thing. But in the wintertime, you still have, on clearer days, you have civilian air traffic. And then, you know, even on bad days, you always have at least some airline activity coming in. I mean, we do get airline flights in and out of here, you know. Mind you, they're smaller aircraft like the Havilland Dash 8s or CRJs, or, you know, they're not big airplanes, but I mean, you know, we do flights in and out domestically, so
yeah,
there's always something going on down there.
Smaller commercial traffic, not the big jumbo jets. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's smaller regional flights. I mean, yeah, we get Alaska Airlines, we get United, we get Allegiant, you know, we get some big names, but they're flying smaller aircraft in and out.
So anyway, you know, he was doing that for a while. Now he's back working at the truck stop and also going to college and, you know, doing much better in his classes and more confident. And, you know, he's been having fun. Him and his friend Brianna just went skiing not too long ago. And, you know, that he had never been skiing before that I know of. So that was a pretty cool experience, no pun intended. Haha, skiing. But
definitely. Very, very, very cool.
So, yeah, I mean, you know, so that's definitely been one of these things to where, you know, as I talk about taking a negative situation and seeing it as a positive opportunity for positive change. And Richard was just like, well, I'm just going to man up in the face of this and move in the direction of my preferred state of being and, you know, work on being more patient and more calm and deprogramming old bad habits and getting into some new better ones. And, you know, that's totally been the case for 2015, the year of action. He's been taking actions in, you know, the direction of his preferred state to manifest the reality around him that he's been wanting. Because unlike a lot of these new agey, you know, twits like to think, you can't just sit there and meditate and the illusion of happy thoughts and, you know, think that the world's just going to magically transform. When you tap intuition, you need to pull insight and inspiration for inspired action and then take that action. Because if you just do absolutely nothing, then you're going to get back what you put out. You do nothing, you're going to get back what? Nothing. So it's definitely been a really good year of action. Did I miss anything, or that is did I pretty much sum that up pretty good?
Yeah, you summed it up. I mean, yeah.
The only other thing to mention that just come to mind, the only other thing I came to mention about it is supposedly one of Richard's relatives ran into Diana, and Diana said something to the effect thereof, why hasn't Richard come crawling back to me? The order's up. I just don't understand. Wow. Malignant fucking narcissist.
Mm-hmm.
Clueless, does not get it. Well, you know, that I told you from the beginning, that is, that was, in my opinion, the reason why she did it anyway. Like, okay, I'm going to put him in his place so that he sees he was wrong. And then once he sees he was wrong, he's going to come crawling back and begging for my forgiveness. I told you that was most likely her mindset on it, because she's a psychopath, and that's the way psychopaths think. And sure enough, she's like, why hasn't he come crawling back?
Yeah, no kidding.
Oh, well, sorry. His legs haven't been working. His middle fingers have. That's
why. Yep.
Yeah.
Sayonara.
Yeah, you know. And she wants to try to take me to court to for having a frickin' opinion. She's going to have to come to Illinois to do it. In which case, I would then have to press harassment charges and really hope she enjoys 26 in California. I'm not talking about the state.
Mm-hmm.
the intersection of the county jail. Mm-hmm. That'd be really fun if she was actually psychotic enough to, like, stalk me and look at my address and, like, you know, come onto my property and be banging on my door. I know he works for the CIA! Hello, police? I got a cuckoo bird at my door.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's something else, all right, that's for sure.
Psycho, malignant narcissist. Alrighty. So, moving on. The next topic is kind of how the deviant art fascism among the DA staff. It's kind of been mirroring the political spectrum in the United States. I mean, you know, for all of 2015, we've seen them, you know, raise prices so that it's like way far outside of most people's range anymore, and everybody was complaining about that. So, you know, they're going to be losing profits big time, and then being completely patronizing about it, like, oh, we raised it because we know that's what you guys want us to do. In fact, we know you're willing to pay even more. It's like, yeah, whatever. And then they'd become such Scrooges that normally in December, first there would be the buy one, get one free deal on the subscription, and then there would be the give one, get one, to where you could kind of play Santa Claus with other people, and then, you know, whatever you purchase for them, you get the same thing added to your account. Nope. Didn't have it. All they had was, buy 6 months at a discounted price and get 6 months free, and doing that or something like that, or maybe it was 3 months, I don't know, but basically it ended up the math ended up being what the subscription prices used to be. You know, that was what, so you know, that they take things away and then they act like when they put it back for just a split second only to take it away again, they act like it's a deal. That's like totally globalist psychological fucking shit. That's total Stockholm syndrome. Like when the abuser takes a break from abusing the victim mistakes that for kindness. Although thankfully I haven't seen anybody on DeviantArt actually fall for that particular line of bullshit. I saw everybody just bitching about it and, you know, calling it totalitarian and being like very insulted. Having intelligence insulted. I've not seen one person say, oh, how nice of them, how wonderful. As a matter of fact, I saw a voting question just today from one of the people I watched. It was something along the lines of, you know, what would you like to see DeviantArt do, ad change or whatever, and there was a list of things. And one of the options was the DeviantArt staff should start, you know, giving a shit about, you know, what their users think.
Mm-hmm.
That was like the most highest rated vote. That's the one I picked, and I hit submit, and that was like, you know, right there on the top. So, you know, there's definitely a general awareness there that the DeviantArt staff are not necessarily, you know, doing what they're supposed to be doing. And it's the same attitude that, you know, our government-selected misleaders, you know, have been having with us, and the same level of patronizing. Like when they get up on the TV and explain exactly how they're going to fuck you over. And then they act all like, well, you should be thankful to us for sticking our cock in your ass and having a dialogue with you, boy. And it's just like, yeah, okay, you're saying we should be thankful for you fucking us? Whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on to a similar but differently themed DeviantArt note there. DeviantArt features for 2015 went really well. And, you know, you could see that when you browse the PSEC 2015 playlist. You know, there's all these, you know, these Hangout feature videos from various artists and stuff from DeviantArt. And when I first posted it, when I first had the idea, I didn't even really think that was gonna go over that well, because most people are kind of shy and not very you know, outspoken because we live in such a totalitarian fucking world. So, you know, they've got this whole like, oh, I don't want to make waves sort of thing. So it can be hard to extend that invite and be like, hey, let's go have some fun online. I'll feature your, you know, your art gallery and so on and so on. People just kind of go into this abundant shock, like paralysis. And I just got like a pretty good number of volunteers on that. And I definitely was not expecting that. And you know, that was pretty cool. So nobody yet for 2016, but we'll see how 2016 rolls with it. But 2015 was definitely a really good year for that stuff. Although at some point in the near future, Brianna and Krista, who are both on DeviantArt, and they both live on a farm, and they both live in Oregon, and they both raise goats, and both have a lot of things in common. They're going to be getting up on a DA feature there, because you know they both said they want to talk about farming, and you know how organic growers are being harassed, and you know the benefits of organic growing, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So. We'll be seeing them at some point in the near future. Moving forward, Facebook's little cock block of TSU, and of course, Sebastian Zubcek, the CEO of TSU, or SU as it's called, apparently after a while, they won that one. I'm not sure if they agreed to discontinue their application for the auto sharing of TSU posts onto Facebook, or if Sebastian was just like, well, you know, we may have won this suit, but fuck you, we're not reinstating our app to share stuff directly because Facebook is a totalitarian piece of shit and you guys can go fuck yourself. I am not sure which way any of that went, but I do know that TSU ended up being unblocked. The majority, probably not all, but the majority of the pictures, video, and other things that Facebook had completely deleted, because as you know, when they delete something, it's not truly deleted. It's still on the system. It's just not publicly available. They restored most of that. So that stuff's been restored. The domain's not blocked anymore. You know, you can post TSU links onto Facebook without, you know, any fear of being censored or anything like that. But the application that when you would post something on TSU and you've got the options there for sharing to Facebook or Twitter, the Facebook option was completely removed, not there anymore. So I'm just not sure as to why that is. I don't know if you know, Sebastian just agreed to it, you know, shut up the crybaby bitch Zuckerberg, or if he could have reinstated that, but he was just like, hey, Zuckerberg, fuck you. So I am not sure which actually happened.
Well, Mark kind of, you know, he had a real fit over the idea of, you know, power behind sharing monetization with users. You know, he kind of didn't really like that idea or model for competition, and he did everything within his power just to censor Facebook or censor, you know, TSU, because he couldn't buy it out. He couldn't, you know, there was nothing he could do, literally.
He did try to buy him out, according to what I've read that Sebastian has reported to the, you know, news outlets and whatever. He did approach with a deal, and Sebastian very smartly refused the deal.
Mm-hmm. And as a result, you know, it's like the typical bad egg from Willy Wonka. You know, if I can't have it, nobody can. You know, I want it now. You know,
I want it now. I'm going to scream.
Yeah. She was a bad egg.
No.
Yeah, totally.
That's, and you just have the little TSU Oompa Loompas come in.
Oompa Loompa Doompity Doo. Mark Zuckerberg didn't like TSU.
Oompa Loompa Doompity Da. Yeah. What do you get when you're smug and I gotta make that rhyme.
Yeah.
I'm tired right now.
Oompa Loompa Doompity Da. If you censor us, then we're gonna sue ya. Anyways.
Yeah. On and on and on.
So, moving on to the next point. I figured out how to do Google Skype simulcasting, which was actually inspired by, you know, and I'll be getting to the, you know, mentions of Vinny Eastwood here shortly, but it was in the first hangout that we did with him and Maxie and Katarina, to where, you know, he had a Skype recorder and I didn't, and for whatever reason he either didn't want to or couldn't do a Google Hangout. Since then he's been able to do it, but so he recorded the Skype conversation and then sent me the MP3 that I turned into a PSEC Hangout. And I'm running Linux, and at that time, every time in the past that I had checked for, you know, Skype recorder versions for Linux, it was just a no-go. So that inspired me to then, you know, check again, and lo and behold, there it was, which then served as further inspiration, like, you know, even though I've got this, it would still be really cool if I could literally link up Skype and Google Hangout. And at first I was trying to see if there was any Google Hangout plugins for it. There were some plugins that were paid plugins, but they didn't do public hangouts. They only did private hangouts, and I couldn't find anything. So what I ended up doing is I got these two laptops next to me here. I've already got a video that, you know, that shows my setup and explains this, so you can look in the 2015 section for that. But I got two laptops. One of them is hosting the Skype connection. The other one hosting the Google Hangout connection over here. And basically, the headphone port on one goes into the mic port on the other, and vice versa. So it's just, you know, crossing the connections between mic and speaker from one laptop to the other. So then, you know, I have the laptop host the Hangout, and then that pulls in the Skype, and then I just participate through, you know, this computer that you're seeing me on now. And yeah, it's pretty freaking cool, and that also allows me to accept incoming calls into the Google Hangout, and also allows me to make outbound calls as well. Of course, I would never make an outbound call like that to somebody without texting them first and letting them know, hey, you know, we're on the air, so you know. So yeah, I'd never be rude and just jump someone and be like, yeah, guess what, motherfucker, you're on the air. No. But this really cool implementation also allowed us to do internet radio simulcasting. So we were testing that out with JP from Wolf Spirit Radio, and it worked out really cool. And Wolf Spirit Radio would do all sorts of different simulcasts anyway, so at any given time, you know, we were on with Wolf Spirit Radio, Ever Beyond Radio, Revolution Radio, you know, it's all
Aren't
the
we on also with Scottish Sovereigns Across the Land and stuff.
Yeah, them too. There was a bunch of them. I mean, I'd have to look up the list, but you know, there was a bunch of them. So it was a great big simulcast, and it was really cool. And one thing, because JP's got two radio shows, Ever Beyond, and he's got Journeys with JP, which uses the same theme music as Journeys with Rebecca, which, you know, was also a show on Wolf Spirit Radio, but now Rebecca Jernigan has kind of upgraded, you might say, and is kind of doing the internet TV thing now through through YouTube. And she has allied herself with Carrie Cassidy and Project Camelot. And so I do believe she's going through Project Camelot TV or Camelot TV or whatever it's called. And they do that through a YouTube channel using, you know, Google Hangout and all that stuff. So when I saw that, I was kind of like, oh, that's cool. You know, I had suggested a long time ago to Rebecca that she consider those sorts of options. And cool. I'm glad she's doing that now. That's pretty fun. And, you know, we had a pretty good time on there with JP. It was me, JP, Richard, Eli Sanford. I think we even got Kristen on a time or two.
We got Rochelle DeYoung, didn't we?
Yeah, we got Rochelle on the second one. I'm getting into that. We got her on the second one. And the first one, you know, it was really cool, and you know, we had a good old time. And one thing that JP on his show that he would always talk about is that, you know, during these times, during, you know, humanity learning its lessons and shifting into a better state, that he feels that, you know, being honest and speaking your truth and being authentic and, you know, acting in your preferred state and setting that example that to others that those things are possible are, you know, better than catering to the typical mainstream radio mentality that's existed since talk radios existed. God, however many decades ago that started, to where it's all about policies and protocols and schedules and content and ratings and etiquette and blah, blah, blah. You know, even Rebecca Jernigan has said on more than one occasion, you know, making, you know, similar understandable complaints about the mainstream radio and just, you know, going, you know, look, I'm not policy and protocol driven and all of that. It's like, you know, just, I'm just totally in the moment. You know, if I'm going to be on a show or if, you know, I'm going to have guests on or whatever, just it's in the moment. We're just rolling with the flow, seeing where things take us. And, you know, I always enjoyed that more, you know, relaxed atmosphere about it. It just, everything was just on this natural flow, and it would just be just these totally awesome, you know, conversations would emerge as a result of that. And, you know, that's the way, you know, we do things here as well. And obviously, especially these times as things continue to get more hot and heavy, we're all facing our malware, so to speak, our mental malware. We're all human. None of us are perfect. And everything that we bitch about that everybody else has done, we too are guilty of from time to time. And if we're not now, then we have been in the past. I mean, you know, just kind of the nature of the human experience. And when we are faced with, you know, things in our external reality that are triggering these things, especially if we've got things that we've pushed down and suppressed and repressed, it's kind of like, you know, that pressurized seal on Yellowstone National Park, you know, and when all of a sudden there's a sudden triggering, then, you know,
let's not talk about triggering in safe spaces.
Uh-oh. Well, we're not in a safe space. We're in a very dangerous space right now, so it's all good. but anyway. So, yeah, when those compressed, suppressed, repressed paradigms have been just pushed down, and then you've got this activating trigger, there's just this, you know. And so we kind of lose control and then might not be acting in our preferred state and might also end up getting a little hypocritical. which leads me into the last and final show that we did with JP, that not only was the last, you know, little simulcast stuff that we did with him on that, it's like even, you know, the last time I really talked to him, and here's why. I'll be nice about it. I'm just going to guess that, like anybody else, he's been facing stuff in his reality, so maybe he's been getting more than a little bit triggered by things, because apparently Rochelle's energy really bothered him, because I had Rochelle on because she's a really good example of, you know, someone who's had a lot of things that have been suppressed and repressed and needing to be, you know, faced and all that, and facing society and still doing your best to act in your preferred state and, you know, learning your lessons and so on. I think she's been doing very well with handling all that stuff. You know, she's had her moments, of course, but overall she's been doing really well. So I'm thinking, okay, cool. Well, you know, here's a so-called quote-unquote crystal kid, as the new agey euphemism, you know, might put the term on it. You know, that has been really, you know, successful at moving through a lot of these shifts. And, you know, when you listen to a lot of these radio shows and stuff that mostly tend to have, like, older people, like, in their, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s, you know, that sort of stuff talking, and talking about how, you know, back in the 1980s, they were doing energy readings and, you know, whatever. I was thinking, you know, it would be kind of nice to, you know, have some of the more modern generations of people on explaining about, you know, the things they've been facing in the now and how they've been dealing with it in the now and how what they've learned from it in the now. I mean, granted, the knowledge from, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, whatever years ago, it's all well and good. It's helpful. It's beneficial. We need it, but we also need to know how, you know, that sort of thing has been applied in the now with generations now. So I'm like, all right, well, having Rochelle on to talk about that stuff would be just, you know, really cool. So, you know, she had a little bit of a shyness going there, but, you know, she was talking, you know, about societal stuff and about facing it and so on and so forth. And I thought she did a really good job. And on the show before that one, I do believe it was, you know, we were joking around with all sorts of, you know, voice impressions and stuff, and Richard was doing, you know, his impressions and, you know, so on and so forth. And, you know, JP seemed to be laughing at that, and he even got out his soundboard and had Spock going, fascinating. I was doing like a little Batman thing, and he's going, meanwhile, in that British accent there. But, you know, it was all well and fun. I thought, you know, everything was going really great, no problem. And then after that, you know, I get this really bizarre text, you know, Skype message from him talking about things that I would have never thought I would hear him talk about before, about how, oh, content, and how the content wasn't contenty enough, and ratings, and oh, you need to get these people that match a certain mainstream archetype expectation, otherwise it's not content, and oh, we have to be professional and ratings and blah, blah. And I'm like, what? It like totally threw me for a loop. Then she started saying, like, and that girl, Rochelle, she was so whiny. Was like, what? She wasn't whiny at all. It's like, I know who's being whiny right now, it ain't Rochelle. And, you know, then, I mean, he was just, like, you know, ripping into not only every part of that, but every part of me that he could. And apparently, it's like, it's not in his paradigm to think that, you know, people like me and Katarina could actually have a genuine, close, solid, actual, real friendship. And so he was just like, oh, you need to stop, you know, you need to let her fly on her own and, you know, and stop, you know, holding her back and but this and that. I'm like, dude, I am not her freaking guru. We're good friends. We work with each other. She doesn't work for me. I don't work for her. There's no freaking like guru subordinate relation here. When we get on, we, you know, we go on air, do whatever we're doing as, you know, sovereign equals. So it's like, you know, this is all stuff that I would think would have normally under in most situations been common sense for JP. He's talked a lot on past shows and stuff like that about exactly these sorts of paradigms that people have. And he's gone exactly into all the details of the mental malware that causes, these sorts of outlooks and the traps that people fall into. And it's like, I just saw him just like basically saying to me and acting towards me everything that he had ever spoken against. I was just like, what? It had totally thrown me for a loop. So, I mean, I don't know what he was going through facing. I don't hold anything against him about it. And I don't want anybody else to either. Because, like, when people get triggered and they're going through shit, like, they just go fucking nuts. No matter how intelligent of a person they are, no matter how good of a person, whatever, you know, if someone gets freaking triggered enough by shit, like, you know, just, you know, it's human. So I don't fault him for being human. And it was definitely practice for me as far as being more patient, more tolerant, and facing my own paradigm. Because I know in the not too distant past, I mean, I was very civil with him, but in the not too distant past, my attitude would be like, fuck you, motherfucker, you fucking hypocrite, you know, and you know, maybe accusing him of lying to me the whole time, like, oh, really, is this what you thought the whole time? Were you lying to me? Were you being fake? Blah, blah, blah. In the past, my ego would have been fucking reeling. I would have been just, you know, using every other freaking name in the book, every other paranoid accusation and everything else. I would have been completely fucking livid if this is like 2 years ago. I would have just been lit up like a Christmas tree and not in that good, happy way. So I saw that. I just recognized this as a reflection of an opportunity for me to face myself as well. And, you know, I felt those sorts of feelings bubbling up and I'm looking at it and I'm like, okay, that's the mental malware. That's the ego. I'm at a choice point. Am I going to act in the way that, you know, I had acted in the past and the paradigms I don't like, don't want, I'm looking to move out of, or am I going to act in my preferred state of being? And I decided to act in my preferred state of being. So I'm actually just thankful for that opportunity. And if him and I no longer resonate with each other, well, he has the right to go deal with people who resonate with him, and I have the right to go deal with people who resonate with me. It doesn't make me or him, you know, bad or naughty or evil or whatever. It's just, it's a splitting off point. It's like, hey, JP, we had fun, and apparently, you know, all good things come to an end eventually. So it's just like, you know, to all things there is a season, and the season of Dave Kelso working with JP apparently has come to a close. What are your thoughts? I need an excuse to puff on my tobacco pipe and take a drink.
Oh, let's see what my excuses are during this circle jerk where we're getting high and, you know, whatever else. Well, it just goes to show that, you know, not everybody's, you know, who you think they are.
Oh, and he said your impressions are lame. That was the other thing.
Yeah, my impressions are lame. Whatever. I really don't care what he has to say. I hardly knew him to begin with.
Yeah.
It's like, whatever, dude. Do you think your opinion of me really matters? I mean, that just goes to show how, you know, smug and arrogant he is if he thinks that his opinion, his summing up of everything, is the most important thing at the end of the day. It's like, not really. as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't really matter.
I think he's just had a lot of repressed emotions, and he just kind of, like Yellowstone National Park, like I was saying.
Boom.
I mean, he's probably looking back on that thinking, I probably could have handled that one a little differently.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Yeah, I mean, really the 2015 being a year of action, I mean, it was kind of really a starting point to what's occurred this year, year of discovery. It was kind of learning how to handle things for yourself, do things for yourself, be your own man, be your own woman, whatever the heck, it was a time of reflection, a time of opportunity, time to make changes that you otherwise hadn't been able to make before, things of that nature. I mean, really what that kind of represented to me is like, just because somebody might look good on an external appearance, it kind of almost links up to what we were talking about with Vinny in the hangout yesterday.
I think JP might have been suffering abundance shock. He was in agreement with me that being able to have a video interface during a radio show would definitely be a powerful tool for internet radio. And it's an easy way to do it. You don't need to have this, glorified, expensive setup. I mean, you could use two of the cheapest possible laptops and then just a basic computer for yourself to interface and just link it up and go. I mean, you're on the cheapest end, you're looking at no more than $500 for that kind of a setup instead of spending thousands and thousands of dollars on, a full-fledged radio studio setup, which, by the way, JP does have a full-fledged thousands and thousands of dollars of radio, setup. I'm not saying he doesn't, but I'm just saying for those that don't, it's a really, nice way to go about it. If you've also got the bandwidth and shit, not only do you have the video interface to where you could bring guests in on video while simultaneously airing it out to whatever, audio-based, radio networks that are out there as well. But at the same time, it uploads to YouTube and you can monetize that. And a lot of these radio people, a lot of them do their shows, they're donation-based, they're doing it out of the goodness of their heart. They don't get paid, and they survive on
volunteer time,
Yeah, exactly. So
especially like with, we monetize the videos here on PSEC, but a lot of what effort and energy gets put into this isn't, on some salary, it's just pure creative effort. It's something you do because you enjoy it. It's not something that you do because you expect to be, richly rewarded, as it were.
Yeah. Although getting popular on YouTube and then having the videos monetized, eventually that could lead up to something that could support you on an income. And yeah, potentially. And it's definitely an avenue that would be beneficial to independent radio people, because then with that money that comes in, they can upgrade their setup if they want to. That money's coming in, they can implement the upgrades, and it'll also put food on the table and keep the lights on. So I think that's really cool. And then plus on top of it, with things like TSU that, will share 90% of the revenue with you, then on top of that, you post those radio show episodes onto TSU, and it's double your bang for your buck. So I think that would be a really, good tool to have this sort of setup for radio personalities. And, then that way, if they do really good with it, like I think one of the biggest problems in internet radio is when someone gets too popular, but they're in a more financially desperate situation, they can be bought off, by the mainstream. They can be co-opted, And if you're doing good on your own and you're bringing in a decent buck, even if someone comes in and, puts $5 million in front of your face, you're able to say, well, your corporate cronies, no thanks. I'm doing good on my own, and if I'm doing this good now, I'll continue to do any better. I'll continue to do even better. So thank you, but no thank you. Whereas normally in a lot of situations, someone starts doing really good, but they're kind of financially desperate, and the powers that be come in and say, look, if you're willing to play ball with us, we'll shower you with all this money. You'll have all the equipment you need. You won't have to worry about food on the table or roof over your head or nothing. You'll be fucking sad. And it's a very...
Well, they use the financial... Yeah, they use the financial leverage as a means of bribery. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, look, you'll have all this stuff if you just go with what we tell you to go with.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Alternative media can be a real cutthroat business. I mean, you can even look at guys like Glenn Beck, who, you know, here in the last couple of years have unfortunately been sold out to the mainstream agenda, you know. Because I know guys like Glenn Beck, they used to be pretty much on the cutting edge. I mean, they used to, you know, he used to cover a lot of really good stuff, you know, and bring a lot of really good topics to people's attention, and then he just kind of fucked himself.
He went batshit.
Yeah, and I think they probably, you know, either they intimidated him into line, or they, because I know he wasn't hurting for money. He was never hurting for money. You know, he's rich enough to write books and, you know, have them published. So, you know, he's not hurting for cash.
Yeah.
So, you know, they probably scared him to death. They probably said, hey, if you don't do what we want, we're going to send some batshit crazy guys to take care of your family. And we're talking like nutcases who'd have no problem, you know, doing things to your kids and your wife and then having them sit down watching each other be executed and then torching the place, you know, because that's how the globalists are. They'd send people like that,
yeah,
you know, on guys like that, you know, mercenaries for, you know, merciless murderers for hire, you know.
Yeah, pretty much. But, you know, getting back to the main point on this, it's just, you know, JP and I both agreed that, you know, this isn't an affordable way to link things up to, you know, bring in more prosperity for radio show hosts. And that might have given them some abundant shock. That might have possibly kind of scared them a bit, like how, you know, Katarina has openly, you know, admitted that a lot of times she's been afraid to move more in the direction of her success because misery paradigm has just been so normal for her for most of her life, because that's what we're all indoctrinated into, this fucking collective Stockholm syndrome pathological programming. And so that just kind of gets triggered and she gets freaked out. And, you know, she's been working through it, of course, you know, and I'm not saying anything she hasn't already said public anyway. And I think it's possible that JP might have had one of those moments, like seeing like, oh my God, this could really work. And then, you know, the malware that we're all programmed with, you know, kicks in and then bling. So, you know, self-sabotage. We talk so much on the topic of self-sabotage here on PSEC. It's not even freaking funny. So it might have been just JP in his own self-sabotage moment. It doesn't mean he was necessarily a smug, arrogant bastard, or that, you know, he's always been shady and finally his true colors are showing or anything like that. It could just be abundant shock, you know, self-sabotage moment, because that is what even the most decent people are programmed to do by the society. That's my opinion of what probably happened. I can't say either way, you know, I don't know, but, you know, that's my opinion. I think it's just a bit of an abundant shock thing, like, oh crap, this could actually go somewhere. So yeah. But apparently Rebecca Jernigan hasn't suffered any abundant shock on that, because bam, she's right up there on YouTube with Project Camelot and full audio, video, and everything. And, you know, apparently Project Camelot is just going the whole, you know, video, audio, radio, full integration, you know, with that scenario. And I think that's pretty cool. And I really hope that other radio networks and things like that, you know, start picking up on that idea and, you know, start doing the same thing. Because I think it's really freaking cool. Mm-hmm. Alrighty, moving on to the next thing on the list. This exactly what we're talking about leads into the whole Donnie Gilson / Truth Frequency Radio Network situation, which was another interesting reflection for me. One day Donnie Gilson posts on his Facebook how, you know, and this is a public post, by the way, how, you know, he's just, you know, sick of the truth movement and sick of, you know, independent media because, you know, everybody's always bickering back and forth and arguing and nothing's getting done. And he's just throwing in the towel. And Donnie had a slot on Truth Frequency Radio. And I was thinking, because, you know, this had been just after the whole, you know, little experiment with me and JP had ended. And I was thinking, wow. If I could get PSEC a time slot, then I could continue my, you know, little fun with the simulcasting. So I thought that was a cool opportunity. And I made it clear to Chris Geo ahead of time. I'm like, look, I'm not trying to like yank Donnie's slot or anything. So the millisecond he wants it back, he can have it. I explained to him completely what my intentions were. I explained to him completely what I was looking to do. And I explained to him my complete willingness to just, you know, surrender the slot. And so, you know, we were lining up to do this. And as I've also got videos about too, on this monitor that I have over here, I had the Truth Frequency Radio Network interface. You know, the slot was configured and everything. We're just kind of waiting on the start date, which was, you know, like going to be 2 weeks after that. And, you know, it was just really cool. Everything was just good to go. Perfect. And then, you know, all of a sudden, Chris Geo's just like, nah, I don't think we're going to do this. And it was really weird. I didn't really understand why. So, you know, I had already announced to everybody that we were going to go through with it. So, you know, I then posted, you know, a journal entry to everybody just like, you know, hey, you know, things weren't, you know, working out on this. So, you know, it's all good, whatever, but, you know, just letting everybody know this isn't going to work out. And, you know, I explained that all this started with, you know, Donnie's public post. And then after that, it's like, again, this is weird. I don't completely understand this. But, you know, Chris basically came to me and said something to the effect of, oh, well, you know, that wasn't really really professional of you to, you know, take private information and put it out public or however it was that he worded that. It was something to that effect. And I'm like, what? It's like, I don't know what you're talking about. Because, and I explained to him that I only mentioned the post that Donnie had made public himself. There was no private anything, that no confidence is breached, nothing. And then Chris is just like, oh, I didn't mean that. I meant, and then like his other explanation didn't even make sense. Just like, I'm not accusing you of anything. I'm just sharing my experience within radio and so on and so forth. It's all very weird. I mean, Chris Geo's a really good guy. Donnie Gilson's a really good guy. I'm not trying to talk smack about either of them. I mean, they're both really awesome, upstanding people, and Truth Frequency Radio Network is a really great radio network, and I recommend everybody listen to it. It's really awesome, and Chris and Cherie Geo have, you know, the Chris and Cherie Geo show, and that's really awesome, and they talk about all sorts of cool subjects, and they have all sorts of cool guests on and stuff like that. So I'm just saying, I don't even understand what happened there or why, but most people in my situation, they would look at that as a loss, like, oh man, you know, I almost got it, but then I didn't get it. They would see it as like some sort of a personal failure reflecting bad on them. I don't see it that way. I mean I look at it this way. It's a signpost. It's just the universe telling me, yes, you are worthy of actually having a time slot on a station that's not only internet radio, but, you know, terrestrial radio freaking syndicated. You are worthy and deserving of that level of abundance. However, it's just not time for that level yet. But it was a signpost. It was a signpost to me saying better things are coming down the road. So I wasn't like, you know, freaking out or anything. Just like when my old YouTube channel, which was at like 6 million freaking views and like over 6,000 subscribers, and I was making like a grand a month on it after all was said and done, you know, that got like censorship fucked. And, you know, at the time I really didn't understand all about how YouTube has these censorship bots that take and connect keywords and things, and it's all automated. And if you have your keywords aligned in just the right way at just the right time when that shit finds you, it'll just shit can your account. Just based on that. I mean, there isn't some army of CIA agents out there somewhere manually, you know, doing this stuff. It's, you know, it is a crawler script that goes around looking for these things. And I just looked at that and I was just like, well, you know, it took me 4 years to get to that point, so I'll just do it again. I mean, it's not like all the knowledge of how I got there, like, leaked out of my brain just because my account was shit canned. Just, although Obama apparently thinks that if he kicks everybody out of the military and fires generals and stuff like that because he sees them as a threat, that somehow that means that their ability to train and command units and their fighting abilities and all that, oh, that's going to leak out of their ears if he fires them. No. And that doesn't get rid of the internal connections that these generals and these military officials who said, I will not fire on American citizens. It doesn't get rid of their connections within the structure. They still got friends in high places. So, you know, that I think that didn't really put these generals in a bad place. I think this actually gave them more credibility and gave these generals an even better opportunity to work even more under the radar, so to speak, towards the benefit of humanity. So that's just my thoughts on it. But I decided to just kind of perceive it, you know, like that, and not like bitch and moan and whine about my channel being censorship fucked. I just consider that as having won my MIB or my Illuminati merit badge. So, you know, the year of action to me was all about taking the negative and viewing it as a positive opportunity for positive change, facing our own internal paradigms and making a choice. All right, do we want to go the way we've been going, or, you know, do we want to change into a better direction? And I personally want to change into a better direction. Next item on the list to talk about. Katarina moved from Costa Rica to Austin, Texas, then to Hawaii. That's just a bit of a side mention because it's just really cool and adventurous. And, you know, we've talked about that, and there was a lot of action in it for her, a lot of paradigm clearing for her, and, you know, her moving in the direction that she wanted to create. And really a lot of good but hard lessons learned in that. At the same time, a lot of really positive, good, awesome things have come of it. And then Vinny Eastwood was on twice in 2015, and, you know, just the other day, you know, for the beginning of 2016, Vinny was on again, and, you know, we love having him on. He's a real cool guy, and we had him on once with Max Egan, which leads into the next thing that happened later in 2015. There was a conference that Max Egan was I forgot if he was host, you know, giving it or just a participant or what, but, you know, it's just talking about the various stuff that's, you know, been happening in the Gaza Strip. It wasn't like anti-Jew or anything like that. You know, it's just talking about the military industrial complex and the genocides happening in Gaza and so on and so forth. And after that, you know, he was you know, walking to lunch from the conference or whatever it was, but, you know, he was off like on a side road, and he just like got jumped by a couple of Mossad agents or something, some really nasty characters. He said the attack lasted like all of 5 seconds or something like that. But you know, did some damage, so he's been recovering from that. And you know, they basically told him, you know, shut up, stop talking about the stuff you're talking about. And this has only strengthened his resolve. So when he's feeling better, he's just going to keep going. Then, you know how I mentioned Eli Sanford and Osprey Radio Networks earlier? Well, Eli died. He died like within a few days of, you know, it was the 11th anniversary of the Pointless Audio radio show call, to where you know, we called this one funeral home that was ran by like the biggest bitch I'd ever seen running a funeral home. And you know, when she was just this real, you know, made it clear that she was a real bitch, Eli was acting like he was trying to, you know, place an order for a casket and saying he'd only had, you know, 6 months to live, and he wanted a casket with the Confederate flag, which makes it even more funny because 2015 was the year of everybody being offended by everything and the whole Confederate flag stuff and all that. But it's like, yeah, almost right to the day of that anniversary, he freaking dies. And, you know, it was a really sad time, but even so, it's like, you know, those of us that knew him, I mean, I was, you know, it's like I was getting comments like, you know, I just want him off my couch. And, you know, because that was just like one of the funny parts of the whole thing, because we pretended that he actually died right there. We, like, you know, we're pretending on the call like we were crying and sobbing. And, you know, one of the guys with us just like, I just want him off my couch. It's damn funny. And then a month frickin' later, Jay Larson dies, one of our very own frickin' PSEC crew. I mean, he seemed to be doing a lot better, and then all of a sudden it's just like, bam, you know, in the hospital, and then game over. Beyond that, all of our social media stuff seems to be picking up pretty good. TSU, I've been using a program more and more called Edgar, which helps automate and put out content across various social networking platforms. YouTube continues to do better. And not only is Richard's NASA headquarters DeviantArt group doing real good, but he was also made the founder of the Controversy Inc. DeviantArt group. Because the current founder said, all right, he doesn't have time for DA anymore, he's quitting, but, you know, he wants somebody else to take over the group before he leaves. So he gave it to Richard. And I'll let Richard tell you all about that story. And when he's done telling you, that's going to lead into the world events section of this. And he's going to begin that with talking about the stuff that's been happening on the Hammond Ranch. So we'll start with the Controversy Inc. thing, move in from there, and I'm going to shut up and let Rich talk about that.
Yeah, so about, let's see, how long has it been now? I want to say end of last year. End of 2015, I was made the founder of Controversy Inc. on DeviantArt. And I'll just kind of read over the Controversy Inc. group description here. Hell, I can even screen share it. Why not? Hit share there. Can you see my screen?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
And as long as you're screen sharing, I will disable my video view with the hope that Google decides to focus more on your screen window there.
Okay, so here's Controversy Inc. on DeviantArt, and I'll just read over the quick little group description. This is Controversy Inc. The group is meant for those who wish to post rather controversial topics and artworks and maybe get into heated debate. Into a heated debate with someone. Subjects vary from religion, politics, climate, economics, etc. And I became
Hey, do me and the viewers a favor and hold down the control key and hit the mouse scroll button so that the text in the browser enlarges a bit, because it's coming up like super ungodly tiny.
Is that better?
Oh yeah, that's much better. Thank you.
Okay. But anyway, I became founder of this group at the end of 2015, not too long before the end of 2015, and it was a great surprise to me, because I figured, considering how large this group is, it's 326 members, 376 watchers, I figured somebody would want to, you know, get in, there'd probably be plenty of people wanting to get the founder position in this group. And of course, it being Controversy Inc., it's been full of surprises, both good and bad. First of all, we had changed some of the folders around and moved things around and, you know, made things a little bit more user-friendly. And, you know, most people, as far as I know, seem to either not really care or they seem to be okay with it, because not too many people have complained, except a few other interesting individuals, one by the name of Flip Switch Mandering, who decided to launch an attack on my group.
Flip Switch Crazy Pants.
And he decided to post two journals on Mr. Dave Kelso here, calling him a pedophile and a malignant narcissist and a self-centered asshole, and, you know, change the group name to Paradigm Shift Spam, you know, things
like, you know, that. And calling you a completely brain dead zombie, because apparently every word out of your mouth is because I'm manipulating and mind controlling you. Paranoid much?
Uh-huh. It's a government conspiracy, I'm telling you. It's like them UN pollution controls. I'm telling you what. Boutros, golly, is in control of this group. You know what? I say let this group burn.
You know what I say? I think it'd be fun to go into the journal entry of accusations on his part and read through some of the comments thread stuff, because the stuff that me, you, and...
I'm not gonna even waste my time.
Okay, well, you guys can go into it. It's, you know, the journal titles will be pretty freaking obvious. It's hilarious. I was joking about, oh yeah, I'm a member of the Illuminati and I'm controlling mind control GMO pasta.
But besides that, I became the head founder of this group, and it's a great privilege amongst, you know, the many privileges that I've had on DA over the years, and it's really awesome to be the head of a group that kind of leads in, you know, political discussion and, you know, is kind of at the forefront of, you know, politics on DA, as far as I know.
There's any video there, which is a really good video, by the way.
Oh, yeah. The Unauthorized Biography of Pete Santilli. But anyway, yeah, it's a really awesome group, and, you know, I suggest to you, anybody who's watching, check it out and, you know, see if you're interested about joining or stalking or doing whatever the heck it is that you do. I'd suggest looking into this group. It's a really good group. There's a lot of interesting stuff that gets posted here every day.
All fellow malignant narcissists are welcomed. Bring your mind control pasta with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But anyway, that is Controversy Inc. I, you know, it is 1 a.m. here where I'm at, so I'm kind of being as descriptive as I possibly can be given the circumstances, but I'm really happy to be a member of this group, and it's, you know, pretty much an honor. And it's kind of interesting to see what this group is affiliated with. I mean, you know, you have this group called an AE We Trust, 8 National Socialism, 8 We Bring Justice, Aryanism, Ku Klux Klan, Lightworkers, Stop Core Memberships, DA Unity Party. I mean, you got a little bit of everything going on here. You got communists, fascists, Confederates, Democrats, Republicans, coexisters, left paradigm, right paradigm. You got a little bit of everything here. So, I mean, it's just kind of a mixed can of soup, as it were. There's really no, you know, solid stance that this group takes. But what I found that was really entertaining is there have been a few disgruntled members in the group that have been involved that, you know, besides Flip Switch, that were hoping, I think, in my personal opinion, that this group would fall and burn and that whoever became the founder would, you know, pretty much render this group useless and inoperable. Which I can imagine this group has probably pissed some people off. And I think it enraged and delighted equally at the same time.
Red many. Flake.
Yeah, red flake, crimson flake, crimson falc, crimson flake, communist flake. I don't know. Anyway, I think it delighted many and pissed a lot of people off that I became founder because, number one, everybody involved. Anybody who was anybody knew that I wasn't going to fuck with this group more than just the, you know, overall appearance of the group. And I was going to leave everything else the same. So, you know, Controversy Inc. hasn't really changed and it's probably not going to change. It's just, you know, there's going to be political journals every now and again that I post and, you know. But other than that, the overall feel of the group isn't going to change. There's not going to be anything that, you know, gets converted or, you know, we're not going to be bending to any political ideology or anything of that nature. It's just going to be a place where news and free thought and, you know,
perspectives
can be shared.
Well, why don't you hit the gallery button so people can just get a general idea of the category folders?
Okay. I mean, you got a little bit of everything here. You know, you got people talking about feminism, you know, people showing controversial photos of, you know, geopolitical historical events, journals, people talking about Islam, Christianity, atheism, theism. Oh, nice. Nothing like a deviation in storage. Don't you just love those? I'll remove that. I mean, you just have a little bit of everything on here. Oh, nice. Another deviation in storage. Remove. You know, people talking about creepypasta, talking about Nazism, anti-Christian.
My favorite kind of pasta.
Or aggressive left. I mean, you just have all kinds of different perspectives on here. You have political cartoons, you have, you know.
Why not browse the gallery folder list instead of just browsing the feature?
Well, this is the gallery folders. I mean, you got featured, featured two, multimedia and video, left, right, paradigm dichotomy, anti-tyranny, pro-freedom, SJW and political correctness, theism, atheism, philosophy, poster wallpaper, flag art, controversial humor, political cartoons, stamps, left-leaning writings and art, right-leaning writings and art, science, technology, and climate, happenings in the Middle East, happenings in Africa and Europe, the Americas, Asia, happenings in other various parts of the world, i.e. Antarctica and, you know, Pacific Islands that aren't really part of any continent, deviantart-related controversy, political surveys and tests, and Poland ball cartoons, which are nothing more than little cartoon ball things that have, you know, nation flags on them. But yeah, I mean, this group covers pretty much everything on the spectrum. There isn't anything that's left out. You know, if you have something that's of importance that you feel you want to get out there to the community, you know, you pretty much just submit it to Controversy Inc. and it's probably going to get some attention from like-minded people.
Rich, you're using PSEC to post your Controversy Inc. spam, you naughty boy.
Okay.
You know who I'm making fun of with that one.
Yeah, I know exactly who you're making fun of.
Why don't you, as long as we're here, why don't you show everybody the group that you actually founded from the beginning, the other one, NASA headquarters.
Oh, yeah. NASA headquarters. That one spans quite a ways back. That's 2011. I turned that into a super group as of... Come on, baby. Okay, too close. There we go. I turned this bad boy into a super group on August 8th of 2015. I changed the layout a little bit, but this group I started at the tail end of the space shuttle program, and it wasn't even a month since I had gotten back from Florida, and my little kind of brainchild for this beautiful group was, is there any NASA group on DeviantArt? And I looked around and looked around and looked around and looked around, and I could not find one single aerospace NASA-related group on DeviantArt. Now, there are plenty of aviation groups already on DeviantArt, but nothing that really specialized in aerospace or space exploration, so I hatched an idea, and I was like, why don't I take, you know, the already popular aviation and sci-fi aspects of DeviantArt and combine them with aerospace, because I didn't want to be too narrow with the content that could go into the group, because unfortunately I've seen too many groups that have been way too narrow on what kind of content is accepted, and those groups never grow. They just kind of shrivel up and die, and they're not really they never really become anything. So I decided to take aviation, which was already huge at the time on DeviantArt, you know, because plenty of people upload photos of airplanes and, you know, military aircraft and various other photos, and there are plenty of artists on DIA that post science fiction related stuff, so I figured I might as well throw that in there because it isn't, after all, an art site, you might as well. And I threw space in there as well, you know, because it's NASA, it's National Aeronautics and Space Administration, and I threw all those three together, you know, and here you are, you have NASA headquarters, and we literally cover just about everything. The featured folder is where really outstanding stuff goes, you know, really outstanding pictures and things that, you know, really are kind of a step above go. Or things that don't really fit into any other category, they just get put into the featured. And then we have space aeronautics in flight, various achievements in, you know, NASA-related aeronautics. Drones, midgets, mutations, X-planes, you know, this is where people can post pictures of aircraft that have, you know, that were tests or experiments, you know, things of that nature. Space pictures, civilian and commercial aviation, military aviation. That was like the first folder that, you know, I already have three military aviation folders because there's a lot of pictures on DeviantArt. But other than that, yeah, a little bit of everything. Space aviation, scientific literature, and space models, flight sim, game planes, and fictional aircraft, top secret black aircraft, you know. Aircraft weaponry, air-to-ground weaponry, spacecraft, aviators, pioneers, innovation paradigms, pictures of military and civilian aircraft hardware, stuff that sits in hangars, you know, cockpits, engines, pieces, space and aviation art. Looks like I'm going to have to move those pictures, but basically where drawings can be posted. Rockets, sci-fi, things of that nature. The group's doing pretty well. It's at 480 members, 586 watchers. It's probably going to keep growing. It's definitely going to keep growing over time. It's just, you know, a matter of time. My group is affiliated with many other groups across the DeviantArt community. It's also featured with Controversy Inc. that I ended up becoming founder of, and I had actually featured it with Controversy long before I had ever owned it.
I think I just saw Flip Switch Crazy Pants group in affiliation there, didn't I?
Where?
I would have sworn I saw the World Events pop up.
Oh, yeah, look at that. I didn't even notice that. That's funny. There it is. Yeah. It's rather hilarious. But anyway, yeah, no, this is it's a really cool group. You know, I post journals on this group a lot more regularly than I do on Controversy Inc. I'm kind of still getting acclimated to Controversy Inc. And, you know, I'm generally a lot more motivated by space and aviation in general, just because it's something that I love and I've always been passionate about. Not that I'm not passionate about politics and don't love having intellectual discussion. I do. It's just, you know, I, in an order of top priorities, this is my top priority group because, you know, I put money into this group and, you know, this group's kind of like an investment to me. And yep. It's an amazing group.
Well, when you're done talking about that and moving into world events, why don't you head back over to Controversy and click on the journal entry about the Hammonds and Bundys and all that, because I know you've been wanting to rant kind of hardcore on that, and you were going to use this hangout as an opportunity for that, so we may as well get to it.
Yeah. It is 1:20 in the morning, so, you know, not really the best time for me to rant. I was hoping to do this when I was a little bit more awake, but oh well. Anyway, you know, I post a lot of good journals on here a lot more often, you know, when I get the opportunity. And, you know, if you're into space, aviation, sci-fi, or anything that would fall under the category of this group, I would suggest, you know, watching this group, following this group, being a part of this group. I also have a Facebook page. If you're on Facebook and you don't have a DeviantArt account, you can always watch us on Facebook, or you can even watch us on or join our group on TSU. Even though our TSU isn't really anything official yet, we're still working on it, trying to get TSU beta figured out. We're still trying to get things worked out. But yeah, if you're into aviation, space, or sci-fi, I would suggest joining this group, watching us, checking us out. You know where to find us. www.nasa-headquarters.deviantart.com, or go onto your Facebook search bar and type in NASA headquarters and you'll find us one way or another. Anyway, I'll head back over to Controversy Inc. now. And I will scroll down to the Hammond Ranch standoff. And basically what happened in Oregon was 150 militia members led by the son of Cliven Bundy, or his name, Ammon Bundy. You know, they seized control of a federal building in Burns, Oregon, at the Malheur Wildlife Refuge. And they have been standing off against the U.S. Department of the Interior, the Bureau of Land Management, and the federal government for, I've lost count for how many days now, and they've been, you know, concerned over, you know, the unconstitutional acquisition of private land, you know, and it's a very noble cause. You know, the BLM has been doing this for decades. It's nothing new. And, you know, I'm glad people are finally starting to, you know, wake up and realize, hey, we've got this monster called the federal government that's trying to gob up all of the land and lock it off and, you know, restrict what people are allowed to do on it, which is totally unconstitutional, you know. And that's what this group of concerned militiamen are out in eastern Oregon fighting against, you know, the tyrannical bureaucracy over. Is, you know, it's not about, you know, a bunch of greedy ranchers trying to protect another couple of, you know, poachers. They weren't poachers. There was no poaching involved. It was, you know, there's 150 militiamen that are out there standing off against, you know, a tyrannical government that has completely disregarded the civilian and has totally undermined everything that the Constitution stands for. And has totally, you know, gone to war with, you know, the civilianry of this country in an unprecedented, you know, federal occupation of land that belongs to the states. I mean, if you look at this map here, I mean, you can see that, you know, most of Oregon is owned by the feds. Almost all of Nevada is completely owned, most of California, most of Arizona, most of Utah, most of Idaho, most of a good chunk of Washington. Majority of the West Coast of the United States is completely under federal occupation. You know, look at Alaska. I mean, you know, it's just absolutely, you know, ridiculous. That's, you know, that's total overreach, oversight, you know. In the United States Constitution, the feds aren't allowed to own anything more than, you know, necessary buildings such as postal offices, you know, military bases, you know.
Post office is privately owned, just to correct you. It's a private corporation.
Well, the United States Post Office.
Yeah.
Is in fact owned by the federal government. That's
are you something. Sure? I've heard it's private.
Just like private
how the Federal Reserve is about as federal as Federal Express.
Well, according to the Constitution, the Postal Service is in fact a government organization. They're all under a government paycheck.
I'd have to look that one up. I would have sworn I heard that.
No. The United States Postal Service is owned by the federal government. That is a federal duty. Delivering the mail. If you're thinking of the United Parcel Service, then yes, they're private UPS. The United States Postal Service, on the other hand, is not private. That's a government-owned thing. You know, that's a totally, you know, do they deal with, you know, commercial stuff? Yeah, but the overall basics of the Postal Service is it's owned by the United States government, you know. But anyway, you know, they're not supposed to own anything beyond post offices, you know, and the basic federal buildings. That's really all the federal government has control over is federal buildings, you know, necessary buildings. They're not allowed to own thousands of acres of land. Now, do I think, you know, people going into forests and clear cutting and doing deforestation is okay? Do I think a giant private corporation doing terrible things to the environment is good? No, but how is it any better to have another corporation like the government, which is what our government is a giant corporation owning all of the land and, you know, restricting what we, the citizen, can do on, you know, United States land. You know, you'd think in the United States we would be free to, you know, do what we want in our own country, but unfortunately that's not the case. You know, you get caught lighting a fire on public land, you go to jail for arson and terrorism and, you know, all these other charges. Even if you start the fire per se on your own property like the, you know, Hammonds did. You know, and tell the BLM that you're going to be doing a prescribed burn and you let them know. You know, so, I mean, this is what we're dealing with. We're dealing with a government that has, you know, plain and simple, overreached its authority. Oh, really? USPS is often mistaken for a government-owned corporation, example Amtrak, because it operates much like a bit. Okay. In independent agency of the United States federal government responsible for Okay, well, even still, independent agency of the United States federal government. But yet again, still controlled by the federal government, regulated by the federal government. Anyway, moving on. But essentially what's going on is, you know, you've got, we have, there are concerned citizens out in Eastern Oregon that are, you know, fighting peacefully against a government that has essentially decided that our voice no longer matters and that they can do whatever the hell they want just because they're the feds and screw you, you're just a citizen that we can stomp on and throw you in jail if we feel like it and there's nothing you can do about it. And frankly, that's not the case. So, you know, props to the Bundys for doing what they're doing. I mean, they're taking action and they're standing ground. And, you know, don't be mistaken, that has a lot of people up in arms. It's a very heavily debated topic.
I personally think wrong place, wrong time, because there's too much potential to try to use that as a false flag. I think this would have really gone on much better if it was more like a Bundy Ranch Part 2 sort of a situation actually happening on someone's ranch and the Bundys, you know, came to the aid of that and whatever. I think, you know, that would have been, like, you know, way better than, you know, sit and shiv at a federal building. Mm-hmm. That's just my opinion. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I share their sentiments, and I hope it all goes over well, but I just kind of think there's too much room for manipulation on that one. I think it's kind of dangerous territory.
Well, yeah, challenging the gorilla on its own turf is always considered dangerous, but yet again, they try to manipulate it, but at the same time, they haven't really been what you would call successful in doing really anything besides just saying, here's a bunch of guys that are just standing there peacefully protesting and they just happen to be armed. You know, yeah, you could say it's bad place, bad timing, but really standing up is not really what you would call bad place, bad timing. It's just, you know, standing up is standing up, and sometimes you just got to draw a line in the sand and say, this is where we stand and this is where we're going to be firm, and we're not moving until our concerns are met, you know, plain and simple. And, you know, that's what the Bundys are doing. You know, they're standing their ground and, you know, they're holding out. They're not just, you know, they're not just going to allow the feds to, you know, destroy an entire family's livelihood.
You know? Why was that particular place picked anyway?
Well, what do you mean, why was that place picked?
That particular building, that particular place. I mean, to my understanding, the issue was over about a border, you know, where the Hammond property was on a...
They picked that property border. As far as I know, why they picked that building is because that building is where the very BLM agents are operated that had the Hammonds merge with federal, you know.
So that's where they're working out of.
Yeah, that's where they're working out of. That's why they stormed that place.
Okay. I just wasn't sure about that point.
You know, everybody says, oh, it was terrorism, and it's like, no, it wasn't. They did it over the holidays. Nobody was there. They didn't hurt anybody in the process. They, you know, they've just been standing their ground. They've been peaceful. They've been, you know, they haven't wrecked the place. They haven't. The only thing they've done is changed the sign on the front of the building from BLM federal office to a, you know, a community resource center, as it were. And that's not really what you would call vandalism. That's just, you know, renaming a building and changing its purpose. But, you know, they're doing what they've got to do. And, you know, I think that's a good thing. And I hope to see more acts such as these, you know, more peaceful acts like these, you know, going to government buildings and, you know, standing firm and standing ground, because really what it comes down to is people just need to start standing up and just, you know, saying, hey, you can't do that. We don't care. You can't do that. You know, and if more people get inspired by this situation, stand up and, you know, use their voice and be firm, but be peaceful. And not only that, the, as far as I've heard, the Bundys have been cooking food. They've been, you know, they've been having, you know, they've been discussing things. They've been, you know, there has, you know, they've been getting their voice out there to the community. They've been, you know, they've been very proactive in letting people know what's going on. They have, you know, sitting there not telling anybody. It's not like a hostage situation. It's just like, you know, they're there standing their ground, they're protesting, you know, they're not holding anybody hostage, they're not, you know, saying shoot somebody if our demands aren't met. They're just, you know, they're a bunch of concerned militia members who have legitimate concern, and they're standing up for a farm family that has been, you know, wrongfully, you know, treaded on. They're standing on, the federal government's going after a family that's just over nothing more since land. You know, here you have overgrown trees, overgrown weeds, overgrown forests look unhealthy. They look overgrown. You know, and when lightning strikes, natural fires creates raging infernos.
You're breaking up
around where I live.
You're breaking up a bit there. You know,
testing 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, I mean, I can hear what you're saying, but I'm just saying you're distorting a bit. Just letting you know. Disable sharing and disable your video feed for a bit so that your bandwidth can catch up to itself.
Okay. Yeah, I've shared the journal anyway.
So what do you have to say to the people that are like, oh, well, they committed arson. They shouldn't have been burning on BLM land and blah, blah, blah. You know, those people, I hear that argument all the
time. Well, I was just saying, you know, it's like they were doing combat arson. I think it's more or less an act of arson on BLM's part for just this total lack of care that they give to the hundreds of thousands, if not millions of acres of land that they own, hundreds of millions of acres of land that they have direct oversight of. You know, they allow forests to be overgrown. They, you know, they totally have a lack of consideration for any and all land that they control.
Didn't you tell me that was basically desert land in that area anyway, so it wasn't really a danger?
There, it's desert. Well, you know, in the woods and stuff, you know, or there and shrubs and, you know, just trees and mountains as far as the eye can see. You know, around here they don't really do a good job of taking care of things. I try, they have burn piles here and there, you know, they'll cut trees down and they'll do things here and there, but they're not doing nearly what they could if they had the proper equipment and the proper manpower to do what they needed to do. See, if they would simply do what the Native Americans did thousands of years ago and just burn trees underneath and kind of clear out some of that forest space around, you know, populated areas and stuff, so there's kind of a good buffer zone, you know, and clear out canopies and stuff, you know. I mean, grass fires aren't really that destructive because they belong on the forest floor, but it's when you have all of that fuel, that ladder field can climb up into, and then they get up into the canopies, trees, raging infernos that you see on TV. You know, really, if anybody should be charged with it, it should be the federal government, because they don't take care or keep it healthy. Or, you know, you have a campfire gone awry, there goes an entire forest, homes, you know. It's like, it's, you know, you're fighting a real uphill battle, you know. If they just simply do what's the care of the forest, you know, making sure that fire fuels to begin with, you know, wouldn't be all these problems that we see every summer out here in the western, you know, portions of the desert. I mean, eastern Oregon, they do get some fires over in eastern Oregon. They do happen. But, you know, it should be, you know, the BLM really, it's not about taking care of land. It's more or less about having just control and you know, it's you know, they found out that it was just about giving that land to some private.
I'm hearing most of what you're saying, but you're starting to kind of chunk out. Yeah, something's acting up and being a little weird right now. I know you were having issues before, then everything was clear and fine, but it looks like you're back into kind of like chunking up a bit.
Well, I kind of, my thing that I really want to say, and I'm kind of getting tired, wind down.
Alrighty, so if that's all you have to say anyway about this and about, you know, the year in review, and you feel we've said everything that needs to be said, then I don't really have anything more to add right now, just except for the fact that, you know, there was definitely 2015 is definitely the year of action that we thought it was going to be. And I think, you know, 2016 being a year of discovery, we're going to be taking the information from the lessons learned and, you know, discovering even more and really, you know, learning how to put things more into practical application, rather than just sitting there shaking our fists. So hopefully, you know, the year of 2015 being also the year everyone was offended by everything, hopefully 2016 will be the year everybody grows the fuck up. Still there? Okay, I think his end might be in the process of taking a complete shit. That's probably the universe telling you. Oh, there he is. Back? Okay, I heard him for a second there. Anyway, I guess this is probably where we can wrap this up then. So thank you everybody for, you know, for watching, listening, whatever. Hope you've enjoyed the topics that have been discussed. And I look forward to 2016 being a really awesome, productive, adventurous year. And hopefully everything goes well for all of you out there. And remember, if you're faced with any negative circumstances, just do your best to view it as a positive opportunity and ask yourself, you know, let's try to make the lemonade with the lemons here, you know, take the shit, turn it to fertilizer, grow the garden, instead of, you know, poor me, I'm a victim, I can't do anything, blah, blah, blah. Oh, there was Rich. So, yep, peace out, catch everybody later, thanks for watching, and see you next time.